sorry it's a bit dark, but the only calm place in the house is my room, so you get a very low light kind of situation.
No problem at all. How's everything going so far?
Good. Can't complain, you know. I took shelter in south of France, so I'm very happy at the moment, even though the weather is not that great.
Okay. And how is it with the current pandemic scene in south of France?
So to be honest, I have not come out of the house for like almost 45 days. You know, it's like
Wow. These
people going to shop and things like that from my family. But you need a paper to get out and come back. And some of my housemates got the coronavirus, so they're more apt into facing the world than me. So we're sharing tasks, but they are the shopping team, basically. They go out and see the world. But I think they ask for permission. Basically, you have to have a letter that states what you're going to do. But it seems that tomorrow it's kind of over. You can travel freely, I think, 100 kilometers away from your main address.
Okay, perfect. So tomorrow, like, much more free.
Yes. Everybody's going to go crazy tomorrow.
Everyone is going out, so that's perfect. Okay, great. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. We already have 40 people in, so...
Oh my God, so fast.
We will have a lot. Okay, hello everyone. Tonight we have Turia Glaoui, collector, art collector, and founder and entrepreneur from 154 Contemporary African Art Fair, biggest international contemporary art fair, and with destinations in New York, London, and Marrakesh. And I'm very happy tonight to have you here, and thank you so much for the chance for this interview.
Thank you for having me. It's very nice. I'm like starting my series of Instagram Live with you. I have now a few more coming. I'm committed to this.
I've been committed for some weeks already. So.
I know. I've been following it. So they're quite interesting, actually. You had some very good people. Some I knew, some I didn't. But very nice point of view.
Thank you very much. Okay, great. Maybe you can tell in the beginning, since you're an art collector too, how did you get into collecting art, and why do you collect art?
I have to say that I don't know if you know a bit of my background, but I'm the daughter of an artist, so I guess my first pieces ever would have been, you know, his art, because I was surrounded by his art when I grew up. And when I left to study first in New York, I took a few with me, you know, to feel at home, and same thing when I went to London. So this is definitely, you know, a large part of my collection, but also the first pieces I acquired. The good part is that it was free. I was like, I could bargain with my dad to get a few pieces without paying for them, which was very nice. And then I'll say, you know, I started discovering a lot of artists from the continent and from the diaspora, but with the work I was trying to do with the fair. So I didn't really buy art, I think, you know, from, you know, the continent in itself before I started the fair. I might have bought one or two pieces, but really I actively, you know, started buying at each edition, you know, of the fairs, probably around 2013, 2014. Usually very modest pieces, but it's still, you know, some good art.
Yes. Okay, we're coming to the fair. We come a little bit later, but when you're collecting, or when you're designing on some pieces, do you have any criteria, or how do you let's say judge, or like choose the art?
I think it's very cheesy to say, but definitely because I love the pieces, you know, there's definitely some emotional, you know, judgment that comes first. Also, you know, then this practical judgment, budget is very important. And definitely I want pieces that I can live with, you know, that are going to be in my house. I don't, you know, buy to store. So it's really important that they fit my apartment. You know, I don't have a castle either, so it has to fit, you know, one way or the other. And even if I can store them somewhere, you know, and I rotate them, I want them to fit, you know, in the my living space, you know. So I think those are the part of the choices I make. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I always give myself a rule of budget, you know, so it helped me also choose a long, you know, very young or very new artist that people didn't know, you know, that, you know, I fell in love with and that I, you know, discovered at the fair.
Okay, well, cool. And since you like your father is Hasan Eglayu, the famous artist, did he somehow affected you or inspired you to work in art or creating something like the fair?
Okay, for sure, a lot of inspiration because you're surrounded by art in your childhood. You know, you kind of understand it better. He talked a lot about it and his years in Paris, his teachers. So there's definitely, you know, an affinity with art that you get growing up with a father who's an artist. Mm-hmm. I think I personally had nothing creative in me. Like, you know, I was not talented to want to become an artist or anything like that. So I had no idea I was going to end up, you know, in that field. I had sisters who were much more creative, you know, who fought, you know, to go study art, etc. What I was very curious is that my father, who a bit of his biography says that he had, you know, to challenge his father to go paint in Paris and study art, but he was never very encouraging to follow, you know, creative fields. So he wanted us to do something serious, you know. Yeah. We're going to leave Morocco to study abroad. They had to be some, you know, very very serious studying, meaning, you know, finance, law, you know, something like that, but not really really art. And I never really understand that from, you know, the way he, you know, and his experience and how it was difficult for him to be able to follow his passion. Yeah. That he was never much more, you know, encouraging in that field. But nevertheless, I have sisters who, you know, who went for it, you know, who decided to go more creative. I personally, you know, always was surrounded by art, loved it, but I started my career in a completely different field. But it's through my other professional life that I discovered the continent. You know, I had to work on this particular market of Africa, so I had the chance to travel a lot on the continent. And I think probably without my profession, I wouldn't have gone and discovered so many cities on the continent. And this also led me to discover more artistic scenes, you know, and maybe started my love for, you know, the different artists I was discovering when I was sent for my profession to the continent. And it is also probably where, you know, the idea came from. You know, it's like all this fascinating art that I was discovering, you know, that I couldn't find or crossing over, you know, where I was living. Mm-hmm. That made me realize that, you know, there was a whole part of the, you know, the world that was absolutely still undiscovered and, you know, not really paying attention to.
Okay, great. And how did this idea for the fair, like 154, how did it came up and what gave you like the drive to do it?
I'd say it's different things. So there was a period where I started you know, working on a catalogue raisonné for my dad's work, you know, on the side, you know, not really when I was working on the fair. But it gave me, you know, really an insight of, you know, his biography, you know, like a whole part of his life that I actually didn't know much about, which was his years in France, you know, where he had a lot of visibility, a lot of shows in Europe, a lot of, you know, incredible reputation there. And then, you know, there was a whole side of him trying to go back to Morocco, where he was from, to build his career in the 60s. So I had that kind of insight, you know, on one side of my head. And then I was coming to the continent and going to the continent quite often. And this is where I realized, you know, if I was not seeing a lot of those artists, you know, on this side of the world, you know, in Europe or in the US, was that they didn't have the same visibility. They were not crossing over those geographies, you know. So I think it's a parallel chain of events as me traveling to the continent, you know, discovering some of the artists, being fascinated by the artistic scene, and then, you know, in a way, having, you know, the journey of my father, which basically got his visibility outside the continent before, you know, getting back to his country and getting established in his country of the continent. So it kind of like made me understand a few things, you know, the infrastructure system that was not on the continent, the fact that, you know, some of those artists needed to have international shows in museums, but also belong to more known collections, you know, to be to get that kind of being part of the discourse, being part of the narrative or, you know, of contemporary art. So it's a chain of like different little events, you know. This idea didn't came at once, it came, you know, by parts, let's say. Like I kind of understood, because those maybe events were in parallel. I was working on the Catalogue Raisonné at the same time as I was discovering, you know, this whole world that, you know, I didn't know before. But it kind of gave me some enlightenment basically between the two, that this was one of the reasons this platform needed to exist.
Wow. And then it suddenly became this big, like now it's like the current, the third destination after London, New York, and now Marrakesh. How did it become so big? Like, did you had like a lot of interest from the collector side, from the institution side? What was the driving point then? Because currently it's now like this trend and hype, like everyone is talking about. What was the drive? How did it become so big?
The idea already was to actually make sure that we're in a city, you know, where it was a bit of an art capital of the world, you know, so we chose London because of that. And then it's probably the first 2 years that gave me the motivation to start New York and then later on start Marrakesh, because we did really well the first 2 years. We're really small as well, but our 17 galleries, you know, some are still with us today, you know, really sold. They didn't have a platform, they existed. They were probably the first pioneer in terms of, like, you know, supporting those artists, trying to sell them, you know, around the world, but they didn't have a fair that, you know, invited them or, you know, being part of. So I think it's really it was really, I don't know, a collective success between the galleries being extremely happy, the fair being able to double in size in London, you know, because we were kind of sold out the first year. And we absolutely had like zero budget to promote the fair or anything like that. So we really based it on the success of the fair. What I knew is that we needed an acceleration factor, you know, so we needed to be as many places as possible where, you know, this inclusion could happen, you know, like where those artists would be, you know, part of the conversation on the global stage, you know, being met by curators, you know, being met by collectors, by art lovers, you know, to get some enthusiasm going on. So we first did London, and after London, for me, it was evident that the US market was the most important one, and we needed to be there to get the same, you know, global visibility. So we decided to go, and, you know, I have to say, 6 years, it would have been our 6 years this year, you know, if we had not have to postpone our New York show, that would have been, you know, very exciting to be there as well. But we also, you know, different type of fair, we're an intimate fair, we're small, you know, so it's very easy to build and to pack and to move, probably much easier than, you know, maybe a fair like Frieze, you know, they have a lot of consideration because of their size. In our little community, we are much smaller scale, you know, so it's been, you know, a very large journey when you think, oh, now we're in New York and then it's Marrakesh, but it's like if you have a tipi, you know, you can take it and plant it somewhere somewhere else. But it's been an amazing journey. I think Africa was always, you know, part of where we wanted to be as well. So since the first year, this is definitely, you know, part of the discussion with the galleries. They had difficulty to sell at home, so we knew that that was not the location we would do first, you know, because a lot of the galleries were explaining to us how 70% of what they were you know, selling was either to foreigners or outside, you know, the countries on the continent. So it made sense for us to first start with, you know, an international collector base. And then, you know, later on, it was very also important for artists, but also from galleries from the continent to be also on the continent. So when we were all ready to do it, we did it.
Okay, perfect. Very, very cool. And And then now currently, like all fairs, like as you said, like has to be postponed, and we have these online viewing rooms. How will be like the next step, the next 154, let's say, kind of look like or like be affected by the current pandemic scene?
So we're very excited. I mean, we have to adapt to the context, you know, so we don't want to be the only person without a platform or, you know, not going online. It seems that, you know, it's the new trend is to be, I mean, it kind of gave us an insight on the fact that if this would continue, you know, we would need another way to actually sell art, you know. So I think the galleries were first to also start their own online viewing on their own website. You know, a lot of galleries did that. And then from the fair perspective, you know, it's all about trying to also give some services to what happened, you know. So we promised the fair, we didn't do it, you know. What can we do in general to support, you know, and make sure that we can provide a platform that will continue to sell, you know, some of the art. I have to say that for this year, because we obviously had to cancel in March, and we didn't really have time to develop our own platform, but we've been partnered with Artsy, you know, every fair, and they proposed to us this great private view, you know, and then partnership, you know, during the month of May for 154 New York. A lot of the galleries are really also familiar with Artsy, and they know exactly, you know, the whole system to show their work with this platform. Mm-hmm. So it seemed quite a logical, you know, decision for us to go with this platform and think longer and more about what we want our platform to say, you know. So we want to develop also definitely a much stronger online presence, but we want to do one that is very relevant to us, you know. So we have a lot of ideas, a lot of angles, but we have to assume that maybe this is a situation that continues, you know, a bit longer. For the moment, we really have a lot of hope, you know, that we do October. Things might change, the way, you know, the collectors get into the fair might be different, you know, the number might be different. We're also dealing with Somerset House in London, so they are also an event place, you know, public space in the UK, so they will probably have rules that we will have to follow, you know, already. We're just hoping that you know, people also are a bit tired of staying at home, you know, and want to you know, still mingle and be social, you know. So I think we've been all closed up for 3 months, you know. I'm really happy to socialize again, you know. And I mean, it's true that seeing art in real is a whole different, you know, it's a whole different experience. And I think we can't deny also the social experience of a fair. And as much as, you know, we might be a bit more scared to mingle in big groups and things like that, I don't think that this, you know, social behavior of us, you know, is going to change if we have the opportunity to actually go out and mingle, and, you know, we might have to have a mask. I mean, I don't know, you know, who knows? Everything can change. We've been projecting so many different scenarios, we don't know. So but we are very encouraged, you know, to be able to go to do October with a new set of rules if we have to, we would love to be able to do October.
Yeah, okay, well, looking forward. But like, you already answered somehow my next question, like, because I was thinking as well, like, because everyone is like doing the online viewing rooms, everyone can say, let's say, even from the gallery side, the collector side, fair side, somehow everyone can somehow save some money. They don't have to travel, they don't have to pay for the stand and for the booth. Do you think like that this, let's say, this current online viewing room makes this traditional fair system somehow redundant?
I mean, I personally, you know, don't think that it's redundant. I mean, in my view, you know, I feel like it also depends on, you know, the type of work you're buying. You know, I'm saying you know, I think people might, you know, provide more unique experience, you know, to see the work. It might not be, you know, big groups, maybe smaller groups, maybe different experience. But I really don't think the online is making the fairs redundant. I think it's the right solution right now. And I really believe that, you know, this is, you know, a way to support the galleries and the artists, and it's very important. I mean, everyone is developing a platform, an online, you know, presence. I'm sure that this is something that they will reuse or, you know, develop or evolve, you know, to be complementary to the fairs, you know, in the in the future. And I mean, to be honest, you know, we have to wait and see, like, see how, you know, this whole behavior is changing or not. But I think, I personally think, you know, like, you don't change your behavior in 3 months, you know, like, so I believe that people are still gonna go. Maybe it's some people will be a bit more timid, you know, to come right away. So the online platform then will be completely appropriate, you know, because they will still be able to continue to see what's being sold at fairs. But and if this you know, this catastrophe continues, then, you know, it's still a good way to see and support and, you know, be a gallery today. So you know, I'm sure that, you know, both worlds can share the same space.
Okay, great, very, very cool, okay, I'm off to move to the next question. Yes, like, since contemporary African market is still a very small market in comparison to the rest, like less than 1%, for example, like US is 44% and UK is 21% and China 90% from the total market. From your side, what needs to be changed to getting closer to these, let's say, big three of the total art market? What needs to be changed?
I feel like, you know, the whole difference, and believe me, since 2013, this whole landscape has changed, you know, immensely for the for that 1%, you know, like, so we have dedicated fairs, we have exhibition worldwide, international collector being very enthusiastic about the market, we have museum acquisitions, you know, that has taken place. So we are in definitely a much better space than we were in 2011-13 when I was preparing the platform. But I think the very big difference between the US market, for example, European market, or the Chinese market, is that they have a huge, large number of local collector. So, for example, if you take the Chinese market, you buy a Chinese artist, you know that you have the power of the Chinese art market behind you. You know, if you sell at auction, or, you know, you have those kind of security. Same thing with an American artist. You know, you also know that you have quite a strong buying power behind, you know, the American market. And you know that if you go to the secondary market, you will probably sell your piece, make a profit, or not sell your piece, but you know that that might include value in the future. So I would say that for Africa, the most important thing right now is definitely, you know, the development of the local international collector base. It's a huge continent, so I can only imagine that, you know, as soon as, you know, we will have the same pool of collector from the continent supporting this art scene, that number will be much bigger, you know. So we just, like, now into, you know, in a way very dependent from an international based collector that we are introducing this art to. And we, you know, doing, I think, at all our levels, from a galleries based on the continent to the collector to us as a fair, you know, and the local art fair that exists on the continent, quite our bit to try to, you know, engage, develop this collector based on the continent. And I think it's very important.
Okay, great. So, and what do you think, like, how long might it take, like, that we're getting, let's say, more closer to these numbers, or in general, like, more...
So those numbers, I mean, I've seen similar numbers, so they're correct. Yes. But they usually refer to auction sales, you know, numbers, which are the public ones, and obviously the ones that those statistics come from. So I feel like you know, if you think about when those dedicated auction houses started their, you know, sell, you know, very specialized on the art from the continent, it's been like a very recent journey. So I think more of that, you know, plus, you know, a stronger visibility, interest from, I don't know, it can take, I mean, I have no idea. I would love to be someone seeing the future. It might take 3-5 years, you know, to get a bigger number. We are just starting to see, you know, some important collector reaching out, you know, the millions, you know, for their pieces at auction. We didn't have the chance to see more artists before because they were not included, you know. So that journey is also is what it is, you know. Like, we started, and now we in a good shape to continue, you know, the development and the progress. But I feel like you know, some of those numbers for the other markets, you know, sometimes you don't need so much of a lot of artists doing those numbers. You know what I'm saying? You have artists who are like 10 million, 20 million, 50 million. I mean, that pool become, and that percentage becomes bigger quite fast, you know, if you take the American market or the Chinese market. In our cases, those artists, you know, that would, you know, raise those total sales for auctions are still very few, you know. So we need to support and, you know, continue to trust, you know, that people, collectors, you know, will be interested, and obviously will continue to buy. And this is also, you know, the roles of museum, you know, all the things that usually add values to the artists, you know, they need to belong to more collections, to more museums, and this will create value too.
Hello?
I'm still here.
Yes, can you see? I was, it was a little bit stuck.
Okay.
Okay, now we hear you. Okay, perfect. Yeah, and this leads me to the next question. Like, for example, like a lot of, let's say, when African artists become more well-known and sought after, some of them will get caught by the bigger galleries, like from these big names, big countries like US and London or some others. Do you think it's supportive to the market, or is it somehow, let's say, weakening the gallery market in Africa?
So as long as we clear that it's not only the you know, the African galleries or galleries from the continent that are having those problems with those artists, it's obviously a very, very large problem, you know, where you have usually younger galleries that is discovering an artist and then that is being picked up by a more important or stronger gallery, you know. So I would say that it's a sad situation for a gallery who has discovered the artist and you know, invested a lot of money in promoting and, you know, placing him here and there, you know, and getting him to get more value. But then sometimes, you know, it's also the journey of a certain gallery, and then is the journey of another one to reach out higher. And, you know, so I mean, I know cases that, you know, in a way, the galleries who are representing the artists now will do more for the artists, you know, so they have a better network of curators, of, you know, collectors, of, so even for the, you know, for the artist career, it is a good move, you know. There's definitely, you know, models that should be worked out between the discovering gallery and the gallery picking up the artist after. I think, you know, those are discussions to have, and obviously galleries who, you know, stronger galleries, if they want to have artists, you know, to discover and push through to the next level, they have to start, you know, I wouldn't say respect the younger gallery, but work out, you know, some kind of a deal, you know, where the younger galleries still benefit from the sale of the artists they have discovered. I mean, this has been said by a couple of galleries, you know, that have done that in the past. I mean, we have not seen so many models that work, but I know that, you know, in the past we've seen collaboration of galleries before they pick up a an artist, you know, they do a show. The discovering gallery still gets some commission on the work, you know, they help produce. There's things like that, but there must be more transparency. It's a bit sad because often, you know, the gallery and the artist have a good relationship. It is the end of a relationship between, you know, two parties that, you know, got along, you know, obviously did a lot for each other. You know, the relationship is mutual. But I know for sure that I've seen example, you know, of galleries who picked up already established artists, you know, but from a smaller gallery or a younger gallery, and they did amazing things with them, you know. So they've placed them places where that gallery probably wouldn't have been able to do by itself. They had the contact to the, you know, top collectors, for example, in the US, you know, or the top residency program, or, you know, so those things are very important for the career of the artist and his journey. So I think, I'm very sad in one hand, because we see a lot of that in my world, you know, because a lot of the galleries are the first one to discover the artist. But at the same time, you see the journey of the artist and the next step and what they are able to accomplish with a bigger gallery. And you're like, okay, you know, if you see both sides, you want that too, because we need a bit of that as well for our market. You know, we need some strong connection.
Yes, I could. I think like they say, like it's pushing some of the market, but in the end, it's pushing the artist too. So it's kind of a correlation of everyone.
For sure. And I mean, you know, that gallery will always be in the books, you know, as the gallery who discovered the artist, you know, in the biographies of all the shows and things like that. But there's definitely, you know, something I would like to see more is definitely the largest gallery being, you know, how you say, grateful of that discovery, and maybe work out some kind of financial model to make sure that the gallery is not left, you know, with their biggest artist, you know, that is now, I don't like to say it, but bankable, you know, and they don't have it anymore.
Yeah. Because mostly rely on, let's say, the best selling and most sought after artists, and then they get picked up.
And sometimes they don't have so many that are in the same profile, you know, so it's but I mean, I have to say in the past, in the little ecosystem of 154, I've seen a lot of collaboration, you know, of artists, you know, being you know, proposed by smaller gallery to larger gallery to have a show in a location that they didn't have a show, that they didn't have access to. Where the artist is still working with its primary gallery and the most important gallery, you know, and it worked out really well as well. So there's some cases where this collaboration is really happening, and in a very good terms, and you know, everybody is benefiting from.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Okay, and when you want to, let's say, when you're talking to a collector, for example, and you tell him like in three words or in three sentences, getting him a little bit closer to contemporary African art, how would you describe it?
Well, I would say for me, you know, I find it extremely inspirational, you know, so I would use that word because it's true. I'm a very emotional person, so I feel the art is full of emotion as well. I think I would say emotionally, you know, charged or something. And I mean, one pleasing word to the collector is that it's very accessible, you know. I think in a way, the collector is very curious, you know, the fact that, you know, they can access art, or even young collectors, you know, can access art still at competitive prices, you know, where they can really enjoy, follow some young artists, you know, that they have not met before. It's, I think, quite engaging for, you know, a collector in general. I mean, a lot of collectors coming to the fair are using the word fresh, you know, they find it very fresh, very different, very disruptive. I would probably use more inspirational, accessible, you know, come and try it, you know, type of thing. No, but it usually speaks for itself, you know, they just need to cross that 154 door.
And how would you like, can you give like any advices for young collector, like in general, like how to start successful a collection?
Well, I think that definitely love what you buy, because you're probably going to have it, you know, for a long time. I think the people speculating about art, you know, there's only a few artists that are, you know, maybe crossing over, you know, the millions, and you discover them at the few thousands or something like that. So definitely buy things you want to be surrounded with, you know, that you would not regret. Do some research, take your time, you know, like you definitely have time to know more the artist, know his practice, you know, if you or have a chance. For me, it works all the time. If I meet the artist, you know, I'm usually convinced, you know, of the work, just because I love, you know, discussing it with them. I love the way they think, you know, so probably without them, I might not have bought a piece, but if they're next to me, you know, and I kind of like it, but I have the full explanation of the artist, and, you know, and it's fun to follow some artists, follow their journey, you know, like, so I think I would definitely say, you know, take the time to understand their message, to share their message, to understand what they're trying to say with their practice, and you know, buy what you like. Definitely buy what you like. Buy what you like is the first thing, not because somebody told you. Ooh, did I lose you?
Hello, are you here?
Yes, still here.
Ah, okay. Yeah? Yes, still here. Okay, perfect. Still works.
I still see you, great. But you were a bit frozen too.
You don't hear me? You don't hear me?
Yes, I hear you well.
Okay, perfect. Okay, great. And before I want to hand over the questions to the community, my last question would be, like, in these 6-7 years of this your fair, what was the most funniest or like exciting thing which was happening, where you still always like remember what happened, like something weird in terms of artwork haven't arrived or somewhere landed in a funny storage, or was there any kind of funny and curiosity scenario?
What can I say about it? This is more the question. No, we had the different stories. You know, we had a gallery from Nigeria once who didn't make the trip. You know, the work did not make the trip. It's funny because we ended up with a solo show that was not expected, because the only artist who was in London, based in London from Nigeria, was the only one with the work. You know, so we had to fill in the booth with that particular artist, and I have to say it was a sold out, so it was not the main selection of the committee, but it became a sold out show, and it was probably the most talked about, you know, booth of the fair, so that was fun. You know, we're lucky with the work because it's much more organized than you think. You know, most of the shipment from all over the place arrive usually. We also have a rules for people to send like 5 days before the fair, you know, so as soon as I know it's in the United Kingdom or, you know, in New York, even if it's not at the fair, I'm much more relaxed on the, we had funny experiences with collectors at the door, you know, because we're obviously a very small fair, you know, they we have a different system, you know, it's at, you know, at Somerset House, or, you know, it's I mean, we have fun with different things, you know. I wouldn't remember one thing in particular. Every fair, every edition, there's definitely, you know, a memory for that particular fair, you know, something that happened. 1 year, for example, in New York, there was this extremely bad wind, you know, that we couldn't stop. We were in Pioneer Works, our first space, and the wind, the doors were just flying over, you know, all over the place. And one of the galleries had their work, you know, completely flying all over the place. They were really not happy. But it was kind of force majeure, like we had nothing to do with it. We had another year where it was pouring rain in New York, you know, that cost us very few visitors, you know, for that particular day. But you know, things like that, you can't really imagine they would happen. You just have to go with the flow, trying to limit the damages.
Yes. Okay, great. Oh, it's great that everything is going so well, but of course, this is weather. You can't influence so much. We already have a lot of questions here. Which one? This one is a very good one. In order to maintain the caliber of 154 Art Fair, what could, criteria have you set for the type of galleries or artists you want to exhibit it in the fair?
So since the first year, we have a selection committee that makes sense for us, you know. So we have a director of a gallery, we have a curator, we have me, you know, that sometimes is included, you know, in the selection because it might be a commercial initiative or, you know, non-profit, you know, initiative that we want to show at the fair. And often, you know, the curators that are curating the program, the educational program of 154, which I think give us, you know, different perspective of the work that is presented. We, you know, are trying to select quality. I'm not lying, you know, and understand also the market where we are in. So we do have a lot of work, you know, that is presented every year. We do have a lot of galleries that we don't take, sometimes because they're young galleries that just started, you know, so there's a lot of optimism for them to apply right away. But, you know, they have not yet, you know, set up their program. They have not yet participated at fairs. So there's things that that we take into consideration, but we really are looking into the program of the galleries, not only, you know, what they present at the fair, but also what is their presence, you know, where they're from. I always feel maybe in general that we are maybe more flexible with galleries coming from the continent, you know, who have not done fairs, etc., because we feel like they it's our role also to be in this, you know, educational system where we help them, you know, being ready for a fair. But we also feel like, in a way, they didn't have a chance to do an international art fair, so they wouldn't know, you know. So we are much more, I'd say, forgivable to galleries from the continent that we can support to grow, you know, than we are from galleries from Europe, you know, that maybe have one or two artists from the continent or from the diaspora, but that the program is not really good and is not, you know, to the level, even if they are, you know, based in Europe or in the US, that we don't feel they're at the level. I mean, sometimes it gives us huge arguments with the galleries that I'm talking about, but at the same time, I feel like it is much more understandable when you come see the fair that you see in gallery from, I don't know, a country where you've never been, that you've never seen artists from, to start learning how to present their work, you know, or how to showcase their work. For them, it's also a great experience, you know, to see the other galleries, the other ecosystem, you know, that they might have not, you know, been familiar with. But I, at the end of the day, we are difficult. We take, you know, galleries that we believe, you know, are also providing artists that will, you know, please the market we are in, you know. So it is difficult, but I mean, what we always try to do is give feedback, try to support when we can, you know, and we have a request why we're not accepting, what we, you know, it is a difficult because we also have so limited spaces that, for example, we don't have a choice, but sometimes to be very selective. In London, we have only 45 booth, there's nothing we can do, you know, so it has to be the best 45 booth we could offer the public. And what we really believe that will work for London. And same thing for New York. You know, we have more galleries from New York, more artists from the African-American artists there, because we also know that we have also a side of African-American collectors that are, you know, enjoying the fair in New York that we only see in the U.S. So we're trying to take all those, you know, considerations when we select the galleries. But it's also, I feel, you know, one of the main reason is that we are limited in space, and we are trying to make sure that we give a chance to the galleries that have a lot of potential, but also have a huge development presence in their own country, you know, sometimes, and they're doing the work of many galleries locally, you know, so we're selecting like this. I mean, it's not an easy process, and it's not an easy role, because we're not liked sometimes, but this is what we have to do.
Okay, great. And are you planning in future to have a 154 in Asia? Because as well you said, like, there's a big buying power. Since I'm working in Shanghai, it would be interesting for me too.
So you have to tell me, like, is there a market for us in Shanghai, for example? I don't have enough visibility of a Chinese collector coming to 154 or sharing a strong interest in that particular market to maybe invest into trying it, you know. But I'm sure this collaboration that could be done, I mean, this is something I really was interested to do. I'm not lying, you know, maybe be around Art Basel Hong Kong, you know, in a different... in a different moment, but you know, each fair has to develop a bit, you know, and be sustainable before we go to another location. For the moment, you know, I think because of traveling limitation and things like that, it might not be the right time. But it is definitely a market. You know, I know that the whole Asia is investing a lot on the continent. You know, there's quite a strong economy link between the two. China and Africa, you know, so I always thought that that could be a link, but physically coming to the fair, you know, we have not yet seen, you know, large groups of collectors from Asia, you know, being so interested, but because maybe we didn't go there, you know, I don't know, this might be the same thing that is happening in Europe or in the US, you know, you have to physically actually be present, you know, to develop an interest.
Yes. Isn't it now like the chance, like with the online viewing rooms, like to get as well to continents and markets where you like have, let's say in previously with the fairs, London, Marrakesh and New York, like have somehow like only focused on these markets, and now you can as well go to South America or Russia or whatever, like with the online viewing rooms, is it like a bigger chance now to reach more people?
Yeah, and I think, you know, by developing your own online, one, I think, strongest point is to be able to see, you know, which region is looking at what you are presenting. I think that would be quite an important, you know, factor of any online platform and who's interested and who's being, you know, seeing the work. I feel like this is definitely, you know, a norm of the fair, you know, if we go with an online platform that will be extremely helpful to support region where we are not present. And this is why, you know, I think developing the online platform for us is important. And I think can have like several use, you know, like getting into markets we're not getting, you know, some collectors that we usually don't reach, you know, with the fair. This is definitely a nice introduction to the art from the continent that people might have not seen in some region. But like, I'm curious to know, for example, Oliver, how did you get into it being based in Shanghai? You know, like, how did you discover your artist? You know, how you went into this specific, you know, collection?
Yes. Like for me, it already started much, much earlier. I started back in 2016. In the beginning, it's like my background is design, and I was like doing a lot of arts as well, like during university. And when I then entered my normal profession, I didn't have much time to do the stuff and do the painting and do the nude sketching, something like this. And then I somehow bought two lithographs by German Gerd Richter artist. And but somehow it didn't caught me that much, this kind of lithography, and then I wanted to buy the first like piece of art, so I sold these two, and I bought for my first piece, which was Abudia, which at that time I really, really liked, and I found a nice one with Jack Bell Gallery from London, and then suddenly like this presence like of this painting caught me so much that I somehow digged into it, and then I saw like the potential of this African contemporary market that it's somehow rising and starting, and that that time it was as well like Sotheby's established the first auction, and then I somehow had the idea like, oh, you can be part of something right from the beginning, you know. And that was for me like the sparkling point, you know. And then I dig much more into it. It was affordable for me as well that time, of course, first job, and that time. So I started then with Moffat and and more and more and more, Kutsanai White Hawami, which is the piece behind me. I can show you.
Yes, I've seen it in the other discussions. It's a beautiful piece.
And Singa Samson, and more and more and more, and somehow the attraction of the market got bigger and bigger, and I got very positive feedback, and this supported me much, much more than to stick, let's say, somehow to this philosophy and focus 100% on contemporary African. And it became what it is today, and I'm still always try to give with my Instagram the platform to show it to everyone, to show about the collection, show about being a young collector, especially because most of the people asking me, like, why do you collect art, or this is something for rich people or something like this. So to be like a young collector and having a chance, having an impact to let's say, somehow infect other people getting into collecting, getting into contemporary African art, was for me a very exciting thing, because it was something right from the beginning, you know. I have a lot of artists which I adore, like Jean Seville, Picasso, stuff like all these big names. But that time, of course, yeah, I couldn't afford it, so I started with this, and then somehow it gave me right in the end, and it became bigger and bigger.
Yeah. So you didn't discover it in Shanghai. This is what I was saying.
Ah, okay. Yes. And then I moved to Shanghai back in 2018. In Shanghai, especially, the art scene is very, very big. It became much bigger because of a lot of private institutions like the Tank. Then they have the new music, Louvre, a part of this. Not the Louvre. Sorry. I forgot the name. Anyhow, much more support from the private collectors who are building private museums, galleries, more and more. Then as well Hong Kong with Philips auctions and all the big three auction houses. And it's ever since it was like a very strong market. And more as well, like I see and on the fairs as well, like Shanghai Art Fair, that like mostly not let's say Chinese gallery, but as well international gallery bringing like African and contemporary African. It's still very few, could be as well of course more, but it's getting more and more. And I hear as well from the auction houses that there's a certain interest from Chinese collectors into contemporary.
Yeah, so they have a better idea, you know, and they probably have, a strong database, of a different area of the world, because they do some Chinese sales, so they're able to probably share, some contacts and some network of collectors between their different location. So they're probably the best people to introduce, to Chinese collectors, artists from the African continent. But I do believe that it's definitely a place I really wanted to go into. You have to remember that I often have those discussions with the galleries themselves, about where they're ready to go next. And I think, from New York to London, we went with funding galleries that had done with us New York from London from the beginning. So we're very small enough to listen to our galleries and how they feel. Of course, we would like to be the platform that goes to Asia, but it is important that everybody feels ready to make that commitment with us, and decide to go as well. But we have a lot of galleries that, started going to the Middle East with Art Dubai, so they're happy to explore. And I'm happy to go, as long as there's definitely a strong interest from the galleries, because I can't go by myself, they need to buy into it as well.
Yes. I think it's a big market, and it's definitely a potential, since money is for most of the Chinese is they have a lot, as we all know, and so I think it's a great potential, especially to give as well supporting the market in general, like for African contemporary.
Absolutely.
Okay, great. Do we have some more questions here from the community? We have 5 more minutes. How do you negotiate the idea that art from the continent is framed as African art, whereas I don't have labels such as contemporary European art, for example?
Yeah, so this is definitely a question that has been debated before, you know, I started the fair. I like to say artists from the continent, you know, rather than African artists. Sometimes people ask me which continent, but obviously the only one I'm talking about is the African continent. I completely understand the debate. I do understand that it's limiting and people don't like to be categorized. When I started the fair, it was definitely a necessity just because I wanted people to understand what we were about and what I was coming to feel as a platform. You know, I was especially, you know, creating 154 to support artists from the African continent and the diaspora. So this was something that, you know, I wanted it to be understandable from the title to everything we did. We had 1 year in the forum. The first year, I think in 2013, which was part of the debate, was, you know, what is it to be, you know, an African artist or a black artist, or, you know, what the artist was feeling about it. And Of course, nobody wants to be limited by a label.
Yes.
At the same time, you know, when I started the fair, it was more about, you know, do you want a platform at all or no platform, you know?
Yeah.
So it was more about if we don't do something that is a real highlight and focus on that particular region, that particular type artist coming from that particular continent, then, you know, the other solution was to not have anything. I'm not saying I've created, some kind of a unique position, but I feel like a lot of the galleries, for example, even the one that are invited now to international art fairs, you know, and I'm super happy for them, but that would have not happened if people had not seen them at 154, you know. So in a way, you had to have, you know, the beginning had to start somewhere, you know, and I feel right now the term Africa is much more positive for what we're trying to do than, you know, negative, you know. So we have people coming to see exactly, you know, what we are presenting to them. I unfortunately still see the numbers of artists coming from the continent, you know, in international art fair. It's very small, the percentage of artists that, even if you see such progress, such visibility, I still can count on two hands, you know, the artists that are present in some of the international art fairs like Frieze or Art Basel. So, you know, it's we did a lot of progress, but the journey is very, very long. So to have a dedicated platform for that is for me is still, you know, a good option, you know. So I will be defending, you know, the specificity of what we do, because we still need it.
Okay, great. Very, very cool. Can you, for the end, like, can you somehow, like, give some advices to, especially we had now the collectors in the beginning, to some artists from, to some advices how to get into the art fair, what do you want to see, any kind of support and advices? Especially
well, for the artists, for sure, you know, we're a bit the end of the journey, let's say, you know, for an artist who's just starting his career on the continent, he first has to find a gallery, you know, then the gallery has to be participating to 154. But what I will, give as a message is often to research your gallery as well, you know, because we receive, you know, a lot of applications of artists directly, you know, who basically did not even take the time to read what we do. You know, we have an about on the website to understand that we usually don't work with artists, you know, directly, that we actually work with only galleries, and we sometimes receive just PDF, you know, not even PDF or pictures of work without an explanation, without, even some, you know, text, you know, to contextualize what you're seeing, you know, or something like that. So, I mean, I think it's very important for the artists to first research the type of galleries they approach, because the work might fit, the work might not fit. And I think it's almost like losing a lot of energy trying to, you know, just send your PDF without really, you know, doing the right research. Look on the website of the gallery, look the type of artists, you know, they represent, and make sure that, you know, when you approach the gallery and you're ready to do it at the right time. We have artists also that usually come on the first day of the fair, where all the galleries are really, you know, into selling rather than, you know, having the peace of mind to actually, you know, sit down, have a proper discussion with the artists, you know, to see if there's a fit or not. But I would just say, if it's if the occasion is for the artist to come discover the galleries at the fair, make sure you've done your research before, first of all, to understand which gallery, you know, you want to approach.
Out in 5 minutes. Five minutes, we can redo it.
No, it had a limitation of time on the on the live
it's always,
as well.
It's always the thing, like, because after then it's counting down, and I didn't want to chop you off from the conversations. Absolutely no. I just wanted to say, okay, we can reopen it. So
do it. I was like, okay.
Continue a little bit, 10, 15 minutes more. Thank you so much. Yes, there are some advices for artists, like, as you said, like,
So wait
because
to
most
the right.
The artists are somehow a little bit shy. I have from my experience, somehow don't want to, let's say, do the marketing for themselves. But still, in the end, they need to sell something to earn a living, right?
Well, there's no secrets, you know, like the artists who present the best their work, you know, and can present themselves the best. It's like it's a selling job, you know, so you have to, I mean, their job is to be able to connect to the gallery, to be able to find their, you know, their unique position within the gallery. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, the only thing I can know as a feedback is that the galleries don't want to speak to artists on the first 2 days of an art fair, you know. So as a first, if the art fair is where it's going to happen, try to go towards the end of the fair when the galleries, you know, have more time. Definitely, you know, try to book a meeting with them, you know, on the particular, you know, day you want to see them, so they can take maybe some time out, you know, to have a coffee with you, see your work, be in the state of mind to discuss your work, to give you guidance. And definitely, if you're not able to get the gallery to represent you, definitely ask for advice, ask for, you know, which gallery they think they might be more of a fit, you know, because they might, you know, have a better understanding of the galleries around them and maybe know that this gallery is looking for an artist, so this is more the type of work that fits, you know, this particular galleries. And, you know, for the artist on the continent, it's not the first time I hear it, you know, use your social platforms, you know, Instagram, Facebook. I know a lot of collectors, but also a lot of galleries who discovered their artists on the social networks, you know, so it's definitely your first, you know, I guess, window to the world, you know, and it's definitely take advantage of that.
Especially currently in this scene, like, Instagram is getting so much attraction as a show platform to all the artists and even to the collectors, and so it's insane.
For sure. I mean, they're in the right place at the right time, you know, with this online presence being very pushed to the collectors. And I mean, if I were them, I would be, you know, using every social platform that we have, you know, to promote themselves, and maybe to reach out to, you know, reaching out to the different galleries that they think, you know, could be a good fit. There's, you know, there's also artists who are selling direct, you know, they're not artists that are part of the fair, but, you know, I've known artists that, you know, have their own network of collectors who've been supporting them for years, you know, locally, and that you know, might work for them. You know, some have agents, some have galleries. You know, I mean, there's always, you know, the right path for you, you know. But I always feel bad because the fair is always already a selection of a selection of a selection. You know, they had to go through a journey that is, we're probably at the end of their journey, you know, like in terms of, you know, being represented, having a strong relationship with the galleries and that comes, you know, really towards the end. But definitely very courageous people that go into that field. You know, this is not an easy easy journey.
Yeah. I absolutely agree. Thank you so much for this insight.
You're welcome.
Super, super interesting. And I really hope that we can meet each other in person.
I know.
Over at 154.
I hope so. Will you be going back straight away to Asia, or you will stay?
Yes. Then depends. Yes, of course. The borders there are still closed, but as soon as they are open, I'm still currently in home office. But I hope that in October I can have the time to come over to London.
I hope the next piece of your collection is from 154. It has to be now. Yes, it has to be.
Because I remember the first time I went to 154 was in London, and I was very, very excited. I remember this. It was in the Somerset House, and it was 2017, I think. So it was very, very cool. I remember.
Did you buy the piece behind you at 154?
No, this one was, I bought, I can tell the gallery, unfortunately it's not
Tyburn.
There anymore, it was with Tyburn Gallery, which now is, let's say, not...
Goodman, but she moved to Goodman Gallery, which is amazing for Violet.
Yes. I think Emma moved there, but...
Emma and the artists, they didn't take all the artists, but I know that Violet moved to Goodman Gallery. Yes.
I heard already that they're not working anymore together. I'm not so sure.
Ooh, sorry. That's a new update.
Yes, but I saw that Violet will be or should be, I don't know yet, involved in a group show with Victoria Miró.
Amazing.
She was on the website. It should have been shown in June. I don't know if it's happening, but it's was said on the website.
I'm going to check it out. I didn't know, but I really, really love her work. I did a TED Talk where I mentioned her work.
Yes, I saw your TED Talk. Very, very good.
But she inspired part of the talk.
This is really, really nice. And I love your talk with Michael Armitage that last year was at Gasworks. London.
I didn't have a chance. I went to see her show at Gasworks, but I didn't listen to the talk. I couldn't come back.
Yes, but her paintings, I remember that time with Alessandra from Taiwan Gallery, it was in Art Cologne. I met her, and then she was showing me the first piece, or one of the very earliest piece. It was a small girl with some chickens. Maybe you remember.
It's a piece I've used, I think, for the talk. You remember that piece.
And then it's apparently she sold it. She sold me, but it was then sold, and then I was like, oof, I need to get a piece. And it took me then almost 1 or 2 years. And then suddenly this...
I know, because when we had her for the first time at the fair, she was sold out, you know, right away. But yes. She's super talented. Really love her work. Still do.
Amazing, amazing. And I'm so much looking forward to what she's now doing in her master in Oxford. And so very, very cool. Thank you so much. Great. Okay.
Okay, Oliver, I wish you a good thing and good news, you know, coming soon, you know, our ways in general. Exactly. And hopefully being able to host you in October.
Yes, fingers crossed for everything for the fair and how everything is continuing so much. And thanks again for joining this talk.
Thank you for having me. Bye.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Have a great evening, everyone.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.